Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Motherhood on Ice, The Mating Gap and Why Women Freeze Their Eggs by Marcia C. Inhorn. Narrated by Elisabeth Ashby. Prologue. Kayla's Egg Freezing and Partnership Predicaments. This book tells the story of American women who have frozen their eggs, mainly because they cannot find a reproductive partner. To write this book, I interviewed a rather remarkable group of 150 women who shared their egg freezing stories with me in an outpouring of research generosity. These women were candid and courageous in describing their intimate lives and the paths that led them to egg freezing. They also revealed the heavy physical, financial, and emotional toll of egg freezing, an expensive new reproductive technology that is never guaranteed to produce a baby. I hope that after reading this book, any woman who has frozen her eggs or who has ever considered doing so, or perhaps who is starting to think about it now, will feel less alone in realizing the shared nature of her experience. The women who volunteered for my study wanted this book to be written for exactly this reason. I have changed these women's names and identifying details to protect their anonymity, but their stories are real and, I hope, well presented. This is especially true for the eloquent women whose stories open each chapter. Kayla's Egg Freezing. I begin this book by telling Kayla's story because in many ways it encapsulates what egg freezing is all about. Raised amid a brood of athletic brothers in a very strict Irish-American family, Kayla graduated from a Catholic university with dual science and engineering degrees, eventually earning her Master of Business Administration, MBA, from an Ivy League business school. "We all did well," Kayla said of her family. "We all have master's degrees. We're all successful. There's no black sheep." After working in New York City, then taking several overseas job postings, Kayla moved to the San Francisco Bay Area to venture into a new tech startup. With her friendly and outgoing demeanor, Kayla found it easy to make good guy friends, but none of these friendships evolved into serious romantic relationships. "You're already under stress that you're a highly accomplished female," Kayla emphasized. "That threatens a lot of men, unintentionally. And I'm not a threatening personality, but I certainly probably made more money than most of my guy friends, and I think the curse of smart women is you want to marry smart men versus men who sometimes do the opposite. So I think it does make it twice as hard for women who are accomplished." As Kayla entered her 30s without a partner, her parents began to relentlessly question her, "Why aren't you married yet?" Becoming tearful as she spoke, Kayla described how this negatively affected her relationship with her family, as well as her own sense of self. "We never talked about it my entire life, and then suddenly at age 30 it's like, well, next step, you graduated from named business school, you have this great job, when are you getting married?" And I had to do an intervention with them to say, "You know, I could have married my boyfriend from my 20s, but I wasn't in love with him. It's not another thing on my to-do list. It's not another accomplishment. Like, I've already done so much, and yet it's still not enough for you because I'm not married yet." I think that weighed on me more than I probably realized at the time. And it went on for like 5 years. It wasn't until I was 35 when I finally said, "I'm not coming home anymore. I'm not, until you stop pressuring me. Like, it's not fully in my control. It's not like I'm sitting home every night. I'm out all the time." But to have that in the back of your head, I don't think is a great step forward in the dating world either. In your early 30s, that's like your time to be out and about and having a great time. And instead, I was walking around and probably unconsciously giving off this energy of, what's wrong with me? Because my family kept being like, why are you not married? Because all my brothers had been married at that time. I still think I'm harboring some resentment around that. At the same time, Kayla started watching the struggles of some of her married friends to get pregnant. One of these women, Beth, spent her whole life trying to find the right guy, according to Kayla. But when Beth finally married at age 40, she faced age-related infertility that four rounds of in vitro fertilization, IVF, could not overcome. This was a wake-up call for Kayla. Holy shit, I'm 35. If I want to have a kid, I should have been married yesterday. Slightly freaked out, Kayla consulted her gynecologist, who falsely reassured her, "You're fine, don't worry about it." Eventually, at age 38, Kayla found her way to an IVF clinic where she underwent actual tests to assess her reproductive hormone levels and her ovarian reserve, i.e., the capacity of her ovaries to produce eggs. "I'm not going to scare you," the woman physician told Kayla, "but you should do this, egg freezing, as soon as possible." The results of Kayla's first egg freezing cycle were not hopeful. After a month of daily hormone injections, work disruptions, lifestyle restrictions, and $13,000 spent out of pocket, Kayla's ovaries produced only 3 eggs, far below the 8 eggs initially seen on ultrasound scans. Feeling both shocked and conflicted about what to do next, Kayla consulted with her mother. "I was nervous," Kayla admitted. "I didn't want my family to know because I'm sure the Catholic Church doesn't agree with it." Much to Kayla's surprise, her mother, a devout Catholic, not only was supportive, but secretly wrote a $13,000 check for the second egg-freezing cycle in order to avoid any confrontation with Kayla's strict Catholic father. Kayla supplemented her second cycle with multiple vitamin prescriptions, several acupuncture sessions, and a relaxing Valium on the day of egg retrieval. The results were much better, and Kayla banked a total of 11 eggs. As Kayla reflected on her experience 2 years later, she expressed deep satisfaction with her decision, telling me how she had become a voice for egg freezing in her friend group. Working in the tech industry with other 30-something women, Kayla saw a definite need for egg freezing in her professional circles, not to lean in to work, but to give women in tech more time to find their soulmates. "I'm not doing it because I want to spend more time on my career. Like, I'm pretty sick of my career. I've worked really hard, and now I want the next phase of my life. So I'm doing it because I want to make sure I'm with the right guy and that I have the option to have children. When you're in your 20s, you're thinking, of course I'm going to meet the guy I'm going to marry, and of course I'll have kids by 40. You're not thinking, I'm going to freeze my eggs so I can put my career first. And all this talk on the radio right now about Facebook and Apple reimbursing egg freezing, that's not really how women think. They think like, I really like what I do. I want to contribute to society. I want to support myself. And I believe that along the way, I'm going to meet some great guy and we're going to get married and have kids. It's not, oh, I'm going to egg freeze and put off dating so I can climb the ladder. That's not how women think, at least not in my circle. I've never heard that kind of discussion before. It's so misrepresentative. And I also don't believe that if a company paid for my egg freezing, that I'd think I'd have to do it or else I wouldn't get promoted. I don't believe that either. Kayla's comments succinctly summarized the media coverage and feminist debates over egg freezing, which have always assumed that egg freezing is about career building, even though most women's experiences are distinctly different. In Kayla's case, her egg freezing was clearly motivated by her inability to find a male partner who was also committed to marriage and children. In the Bay Area, Kayla explained to me, women in her circles were constantly lamenting the Peter Pans, men who never grow up and do not want to start a family. They have all the money that they want, they can buy all the toys, and women are somewhat disposable to them, Kayla opined. So they just wine and dine you. Kayla described her last partner, Matt, as fitting this profile to some extent. He was a really successful, handsome boyfriend, Kayla told me. We used to go out to favorite restaurants. We used to go fly places. But it was clear to Kayla that Matt's main passions were surfing and skiing, and that he had no desire to settle down. When Kayla finally decided to freeze her eggs, Matt was supportive, but silent about his own intentions. It was then that Kayla realized the truth about Matt, a trust fund kid who was never going to commit. Kayla broke it off after a year and a half spent together. When I asked Kayla if egg freezing had somehow taken the pressure off finding another partner, she told me emphatically, "It's the best decision I ever made." Like, turning 40 was hard enough, but knowing that I had frozen my eggs was this huge relief off my shoulders, because I want kids. And I've told guys I've dated, because they'll say, "Oh, you're 40, do you want to have kids?" And you can see they're looking at you with this like, "Oh shit, if you say yes, that means you want to get married next month and I'm out of here." But if you say, "Yeah, I want to have kids, I froze my eggs," they're a little bit shocked that you talk about it. But I'll be like, "Yeah, I do want to have kids and I froze my eggs a couple years ago." Eventually, through online dating, Kayla met her current boyfriend, Will. Will was not the Irish Catholic finance guy that Kayla had always imagined she might marry, and he was also divorced, a huge demerit in the eyes of the Catholic Church. Still, Kayla found Will to be handsome, fun, and flirty, and she was very impressed by Will's insistence on their first date, "I want to get married and have kids." Yet, on their second date, Will asked Kayla why she had never been married, telling her, "Look, I'm really attracted to you. I think you're incredibly smart, clearly well-traveled, and you're really good at witty banter, which guys love and most girls suck at. So what's wrong with you? Why are you still single?" Apparently, Will's friends were asking him the same question, which put Kayla immediately on the defensive. She explained that she had wasted valuable time on her last relationship with Matt, a type B surfer dude. Now 4 months into her relationship with Will, Kayla was feeling insecure and anxious. Will admitted to Kayla that he had cheated on his ex-wife, leading to marital acrimony, a drawn-out divorce, and alimony payments that included egg freezing. Kayla was beginning to wonder whether she could trust Will. "My concern right now is that he likes to tease by saying he's a narcissist, and I don't really want to be with a narcissist. And right now he's being chased by this 30-year-old Russian girl, and it's driving me bonkers. He's pinning me as the jealous girlfriend, and it's pissing me off because I was like, I think you're being really disrespectful to me, because why can't you set boundaries with her?" Kayla went on to describe another recent conversation she had had with Will and his friends about what they were looking for in a woman. "I mean, they can be just really critical, like, I don't like her nose, or I don't like her this or that. They can be very focused on the physical, for sure. And their younger friend, he wants a really professional woman who's a pro skier, who's traveled the world. I was like, I know a ton of those women, and they're still single. So you say that you want that, but why won't you date that? Is it because they're also not a Victoria's Secret model on top of it all? Like, what's the unicorn that you're chasing? Because you're not perfect either." Kayla was also disconcerted by the way that Will and his friends talked about women's aging and the risk of partnering with an older woman. Trying to appear non-judgmental, Will had told his friends, "Yeah, but Kayla's totally de-risked. Like, she's 40, she's gorgeous, and I know what I'm going to get. It's not like I'm dating this 30-year-old who's going to turn into this gnome when she's 50. Kayla had never heard the de-risked term before, but she wondered whether her frozen eggs were part of Will's risk assessment. Will had recently told Kayla that he loved her, but as she confided to me, "I can't really say it back until I feel more secure." She continued, "I think right now, the influence of the 30-year-old hot Russian girl chasing him, you know, men, they do get pulled in other directions. You know, it's like the last week he's been doing more behaviors of a 30-year-old. So I want to say, I love you back, but I'm not feeling secure right now because of your behavior." Over 2 hours and a box of Kleenex, Kayla spilled out her story, inciting my own disquiet and dismay. On the surface, Kayla was a bright, friendly, attractive, highly educated, professional woman who felt that she had done everything right, yet things just seemed to be getting worse and worse. While professional success had come easily to Kayla, stable romantic relationships continued to elude her. With her best reproductive years well behind her, Kayla had frozen her eggs at age 38 at a staggering cost, more than $25,000, an amount totaling more than one-third of the average U.S. household income in 2020. This investment served to relieve Kayla's reproductive stress and boost her dating confidence. But those frozen eggs were cold comfort amid the larger gender and relationship issues that she still faced. Partnership predicaments. Over a multi-year study, I met dozens and dozens and dozens of highly educated professional women like Kayla from diverse racial, religious, and regional backgrounds. Although the details of their stories varied, they were overwhelmingly freezing their eggs for one reason: heterosexual relationship troubles. This would be a disturbing finding for any gender scholar, but for me, my discomfort ran deep for several reasons. First, I could not help but compare what I was hearing from American women to what I already knew about gender relations in the Middle East, the region of the world where I have conducted research for more than 35 years. In fact, I have written 6 books on gender, reproduction, and family life in the Middle East, arguing that gender relations have changed for the better over time. In my most well-known book on the subject, The New Arab Man, I provide multiple examples of what I call emergent masculinities, or the ways in which new generation Arab men are challenging patriarchy, changing norms of manhood, and practicing more egalitarian gender relations. To take but one example, Arab men today now strive for what I call conjugal connectivity, the intense sharing of romantic love, sexual intimacy, everyday companionship, and a firm sense of committed, long-term partnership within marriage. Overall, Arab men are very marriage-oriented, making the Middle East the most married region of the world, with more than 90% of all adults marrying at least once in their lifetimes. Arab men see marriage as a fundamental aspect of their masculine identities, and they strive to achieve this important marker of masculine success even amid the waithood or marriage delay caused by serious economic obstacles. Indeed, in uncertain political and economic circumstances, marrying an educated woman with a career path is seen by most men as a tremendous asset. Moreover, once married, both Middle Eastern men and women generally want children, considering them to be the greatest joy and reward in life. Middle Eastern men generally cherish their fatherhood roles, taking great pride in being loving babas, or daddies, to their children. For example, on any Middle Eastern airplane flight, men can be seen carrying and cuddling their babies, walking with their toddlers up and down the aisles, going to the restroom to change diapers, finding food and entertainment for their older children, and generally sharing the mundane tasks of parenthood with their wives. They also lavish this attention on other people's children, a kind of affection rare to behold in the West. Just think of long-haul flights where children are considered a nuisance and their crying an affront. In short, over more than three decades, I have enjoyed watching and documenting this increasingly gender-egalitarian Arab world, where good marriages and happy families are many men's passionate commitment. Thus, returning to my own country and hearing countless stories like Kayla's came as something of a shock. What was happening to gender relations in my own country? Why were educated women having so much trouble finding men? Was this the tragedy of heterosexuality described by the queer theorist Jane Ward, who has argued powerfully that being straight benefits men but not always women? Indeed, women in the West are often portrayed as the greatest beneficiaries of feminism, freedom, reproductive rights, and gender equality, making their lives seem the best and most fulfilled. Yet many women I interviewed had confronted patriarchy, misogyny, ego fragility, and sexism, male attributes that are assumed to exist in other places like the Middle East, but may, in fact, govern heterosexual women's lives and relationships in the U.S., and perhaps in other Western countries. In story after story, American women told me about men's feelings of intimidation, with women's higher earnings invoking particular feelings of emasculation. I learned a great deal about men's ageism, and particularly the rejection of women in their late 30s, who were seen as over the hill and desperate for marriage. I heard about men's objectification of women's bodies and their critique of women's appearances, both online and in person. I listened to women's stories of men's bad behavior, from the casual ghosting in online dating to the actual cheating in sexual relationships. And I heard about Peter Pans and many other types of men, from alpha males to beta males and so on, who were simply unready or unwilling to commit to women. Although these women fit all the markers of success in the U.S. and all the characteristics deemed worthy of marriage, the men they met were far from their fantasies. Thus, the vast majority of women I interviewed found themselves in their late 30s without partners. Egg freezing was not about their careers. It was about being single or in very unstable relationships with men who were unwilling to commit to them. This situation also caused me to ask, why have things not changed since my generation? These kinds of stories felt achingly familiar to me, spurring me to reflect back on my younger self. Growing up in a beer-drinking, sports-loving Midwestern college town, I found myself always out of place. Nicknamed Inhorn the Egghead and voted most likely to succeed in high school, I entered college on a full-tuition cello scholarship and spent more time in concert halls and on the university arts newspaper than attending football games and drinking beer with the guys. Heading straight to New York City after graduation to work as a journalist, I still did not find my soulmate, settling instead for some very unequal and unsatisfactory romantic relationships. Eventually, I moved across country for graduate school, where most of my classmates were women entering their early 30s and in the same situation. Although they obtained their PhDs, many of my friends never went on to marry or settled for suboptimal relationships that subsequently ended. I was in the latter category, painfully extricating myself from a dysfunctional relationship with a much older man, including a brief and disastrous marriage. Following my divorce, I contemplated using donor insemination to become a single mother. Children were the one thing I knew I wanted, even if I never partnered again. But I eventually met the man who was to become the father of my children. He had yet to finish college, but he was intelligent and kind, and not opposed to moving from my job or having children. Over the next several years, my new husband returned to college, eventually obtaining his master's degree. I, meanwhile, struggled to bear our children amid the ticking of both my biological and tenure clocks. Our first pregnancy ended with malpractice. The physician who performed an amniocentesis for me as I turned 35 failed to detect my twin pregnancy, even though, with my distended belly, I had asked him about this possibility, and he callously brushed me off in a dismal display of poor bedside manner. At the beginning of my third trimester, my second twin was finally detected on ultrasound. But by then, my pregnancy was in serious trouble due to a complication of the identical twins' shared placenta. Sadly, I delivered our baby daughters stillborn at 26 weeks gestation. This was followed by an early miscarriage. Finally, our son was born when I was 37, our daughter at age 40, the same year I received tenure. Frankly, if egg freezing had been available at the end of the 20th century, I would have strongly considered it, simply to relieve the reproductive pressure and to give myself some kind of backup. Having gone through my own reproductive losses and heartache, I feel great compassion for any woman whose reproductive desires go unrequited, whatever the obstacles might be. I also know how much partnership and parenting mean to me and why these desires are so strongly felt by many other women. As this book on egg freezing will clearly show, women like Kayla are doing the best they can under less than ideal circumstances to give themselves a hard-fought reproductive chance. Thus, in reflecting back on Kayla's story, the question should not be, what's wrong with Kayla, but rather, what societal factors are causing women like Kayla to freeze their eggs? Decades on from my own struggle, why is it still so difficult for educated professional women from every race, religion, and region of the country to achieve stable partnerships and to mother the children of their dreams? Why has a substantial shift in gender relations not occurred since my baby boom generation? Given the disheartening reality of these ongoing gender troubles, what can egg freezing achieve for modern women like Kayla? What kind of cold comfort do their frozen eggs provide? These are the questions to be taken up in this book, which may be about a woman like you or about someone you know and love. And what about Kayla? She contacted me 5 years after our first meeting, and this is what she had to say. I'm still in the camp of, where is my partner, which is never how I expected my life to pan out. I'm incredibly grateful that I froze my eggs, but I'm also sad that I'm turning 45 this year and still do not have a partner and family. I never expected this to be my life. I'm moving to a different state and hope that a fresh start and a focus on making time to actively date will result in a much better love life than in SF and NYC. I'm determined to stay positive and hopeful. Ultimately, egg freezing technology could do nothing to solve Kayla's ongoing partnership predicament. But with frozen eggs in the bank, at least Kayla could hold out hope of achieving her motherhood dream. Introduction: The Rise of Egg Freezing. Egg Freezing: A Brief History. To begin the story of egg freezing and why women like Kayla are now staking their reproductive futures on it, we must take a brief journey backward in time to the beginnings of IVF. On July 25, 1978, Louise Brown, the world's first test tube baby, was born in Oldham, England. For Leslie and John Brown, the working-class parents of baby Louise, IVF was their hope technology, allowing them to overcome 9 years of heartbreaking, involuntary childlessness. Although both feminists and religious leaders were quick to condemn IVF on various grounds, the first generation of infertile couples to use IVF were full of enthusiasm and admiration, describing this new reproductive technology as a miracle, a good fortune, and a sign of scientific progress. Fast forward 4 decades to 2018. Louise Brown, now a mother of 2 young sons, has turned 40 with great media fanfare. Her memoir, Louise Brown, My Life as the World's First Test Tube Baby, 2015, is promoted as part of IVF's 40th anniversary celebration. The European Society of Human Reproduction and Embryology, ESHRE, one of the 2 main IVF professional organizations in the world, announces that more than 8 million IVF babies have been born, including at least 4% of all children in Western societies. But IVF has birthed more than babies. IVF has been called the platform technology for all that has followed, including a multitude of second-generation assisted reproductive technologies, ARTs. These range from intracytoplasmic sperm injection, ICSI, to overcome male infertility, to pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, PGD, to detect chromosomal abnormalities and the sex of IVF embryos, to human embryonic stem cells, HESC, for therapeutic use in regenerative medicine. Egg freezing is one of these IVF offspring. Techniques to freeze human sperm were already mastered by the 1970s, and human embryo freezing followed within the first few years of IVF's existence. But the freezing of human eggs proved technologically difficult. The human egg is the largest cell in the human body, with a high water content, and therefore prone to lethal ice crystal formation during the freezing process. Slow freezing techniques being used in the 1980s and 1990s were unreliable. Eggs that survived freezing and rewarming often demonstrated chromosomal damage, leading to poor embryo development and ultimately low overall birth rates. So, although the first reported frozen egg baby was born in 1986, only 8 years after Louise Brown's birth, egg freezing was not considered safe or effective by the end of the 20th century. Not until 2005 was a new method of flash freezing called oocyte vitrification successfully developed by a research embryologist in Japan and eventually introduced into clinical trials in the US and other countries. Vitrification is a process by which human eggs are first treated with cryoprotective substances and then submerged into liquid nitrogen. The cells cool so rapidly to minus 320 degrees Fahrenheit that they become vitrified or glass-like in their structure. Unlike older slow freezing methods, which took hours to complete, the vitrification process takes minutes. Furthermore, egg survival post-rewarming can be as high as 90% with vitrification, with good evidence that fertilization and pregnancy rates are similar between fresh and frozen eggs. Safety data are also reassuring, with no apparent increased rates of birth defects or developmental deficits in the children born from frozen eggs. Thus, the birth of vitrification technology at the turn of the 21st century has proven to be a game changer. It has simplified the egg freezing procedure, increased its efficiency, and improved overall birth outcomes. Initial demand for this new egg freezing technology was found in the world of clinical oncology. Female cancer patients of reproductive age, generally young women in their teens, 20s, or early 30s, are at risk of infertility because many forms of oncological treatment, including both radiation and chemotherapy, destroy or diminish a woman's ovarian function. If patients' eggs can be retrieved from their ovaries, then frozen and stored prior to cancer treatment, female cancer survivors can be given the chance to use their frozen eggs at a future date to conceive biogenetically related offspring. This opportunity was already available to young male cancer patients through sperm freezing. Egg freezing clinical trials thus began with cancer patients, but they soon opened up to women with other fertility-threatening medical conditions. These include severe endometriosis, benign ovarian tumors, autoimmune disorders, and a variety of genetic profiles, such as BRCA1 and 2, Turner syndrome, and Fragile X syndrome. However, the major expansion of egg freezing clinical trials occurred when otherwise healthy single women in their mid to late 30s began volunteering for egg vitrification studies, most of which were being conducted in academic IVF clinics. Healthy women's concerns revolved around reproductive aging, the fact that a woman's ovarian reserve, or the number and quality of her eggs, diminishes over time, beginning around age 32 and accelerating rapidly around age 37. If a woman freezes her eggs at age 35, she can potentially use those 35-year-old eggs in her 40s and beyond, because as a woman ages, her frozen eggs do not. Furthermore, egg age, not womb age, appears to be the most critical variable in a woman's ability to carry a pregnancy to term, as had already been demonstrated through the successful use of younger donor eggs to help older women become mothers. Thus, even a postmenopausal woman can carry and give birth to a frozen egg baby with the support of hormone therapy and an IVF cycle. In other words, egg freezing by vitrification has made possible the extension of a woman's reproductive lifespan, forestalling the inevitability of age-related infertility, which, for most women, occurs by the time they reach their early 40s. The clinical trials undertaken throughout the early 2000s thus helped to confirm two main categories of egg freezing. One became known as medical egg freezing and was being offered mainly to young cancer patients within an emerging field of oncofertility. The other was called by a number of names, including non-medical, social, or elective egg freezing, but was being directed at otherwise healthy women who were concerned about age-related fertility decline. Even though medical and non-medical egg freezing were categorized separately, it is important to point out that both were ultimately directed at the prevention of future infertility, a condition that affects approximately 10% of all reproductive-aged women worldwide. Egg freezing by vitrification remained experimental in the U.S., as elsewhere, until the beginning of the 2010s. Israel, A country always on the cutting edge of assisted reproductive technology development was the first to move egg freezing by vitrification into clinical practice in January 2011. The United States soon followed. On October 19, 2012, the American Society for Reproductive Medicine, ASRM, the world's other main IVF professional organization, lifted the experimental label, allowing egg freezing to be used for both medical and non-medical purposes. ASRM's European counterpart, ESHRE, agreed with this decision the same year. Still, ASRM urged caution, stopping short of recommending egg freezing as a way to actually postpone childbearing. As it pointed out, there were insufficient data on safety, success rates, cost-effectiveness, and physical and emotional risks to women, who might be lulled into a false sense of security through egg freezing. Furthermore, reliable data on the ultimate success of egg freezing were not readily available, as so few women in the experimental phase had yet returned to use their frozen eggs. In other words, according to ASRM, the viability of egg freezing and what it would ultimately mean for women and their future children remained highly uncertain. Having said this, as soon as the experimental restrictions were lifted in late 2012, IVF clinics across the U.S. began providing egg freezing cycles to women, and some clinics also began creating their own frozen egg banks. The response on the part of American women was also immediate. Approximately 5,000 egg freezing cycles were undertaken in the U.S. in 2013, the first full year of clinical approval. By 2018, 5 years later, that number had more than doubled to nearly 11,000 cycles, according to the Society for Assisted Reproductive Technology, SART, which is charged with keeping track of such cycles in the U.S. By the end of the decade, more than 36,000 American women had frozen their eggs, with that number expected to increase exponentially. Today, most U.S. IVF clinics now offer both medical and non-medical egg freezing as a routine service, and several commercial standalone egg freezing clinics, such as Extend Fertility and Kind Body, have opened up in major cities such as New York and San Francisco. It is important to note that although many U.S. IVF clinics temporarily closed due to the onset of COVID-19, their reopening in the summer of 2020 led to a surge in egg freezing requests, reflecting pent-up demand for services among American women. For example, in Manhattan, New York University's Langone Prelude Fertility Center recorded a 41% increase in egg freezing cycles during the period from June to September 2020. Portraying egg freezing. So, why are American women clamoring for egg freezing? What new opportunities does egg freezing afford? From the very beginning, much has been said about what egg freezing can do for women. For example, egg freezing has been called a reproductive backstop, a form of fertility insurance, a means to create an egg savings account, and a way for 30-something women to rewind the biological clock. With egg freezing, younger women in their 20s can potentially put their fertility on hold, defer childbearing, and postpone motherhood until they are ready. The ability to freeze fertility in time, putting off childbearing until a later date, has been heralded as a reproductive revolution, equivalent to the introduction of the birth control pill in the 1960s. Prominent IVF physicians have contributed to these optimistic portrayals, including a series of review articles on egg freezing's potential. Egg freezing, they have argued, is not only a way to forestall age-related infertility, it can also be used by women in an intentional, forward-looking manner to delay, defer, or postpone their fertility, especially for educational and career purposes. Such fertility postponement, in turn, can help women to achieve reproductive autonomy and also level the playing field with men, given that men have no equivalent reproductive time pressure. ASRM, too, has weighed in on egg freezing's potential. In an important 2018 ASRM Ethics Committee statement titled "Planned Oocyte Cryopreservation for Women Seeking to Preserve Reproductive Potential," ASRM called egg freezing an emerging but ethically permissible procedure that may help women avoid future infertility. The most notable aspect of this ASRM statement was the use of the word planned as the most appropriate descriptor for non-medical egg freezing, a rhetorical move with several important implications. First, ASRM's advocacy of the term planned as the proper adjective for non-medical egg freezing suggested that the older term social be supplanted. For many women, this represented a welcome step forward, given their critique of the ways in which the term social trivialized their experiences, even suggesting that egg freezing might be fun. Second, ASRM's use of the term planned solidified the distinction between medical and non-medical egg freezing. Medical egg freezing can rarely be planned in advance, as it most often occurs on an urgent basis immediately following a cancer diagnosis and prior to chemotherapy. Thus, adding the term planned for non-medical egg freezing acknowledged the distinction between urgent versus non-urgent fertility care. Third, calling non-medical egg freezing planned suggested that this technology could be used for intentional planning purposes, for example, to forestall fertility during the period of graduate education. Furthermore, by invoking issues of planning, ASRM placed this technology squarely within the realm of family planning as another reproductive choice women could make to shape their reproductive destinies. Yet, whereas most modern family planning methods are more than 90% effective, egg freezing is not. As we will see, the existence of frozen eggs cannot guarantee the birth of a future frozen egg baby. Perhaps recognizing the danger of creating false hopes and expectations, the ASRM Ethics Committee added an important caveat to its 2018 statement, arguing that because egg freezing is new and evolving, it is essential that women who are considering using it be informed about the uncertainties regarding its efficacy and long-term effects. ASRM's somewhat ambivalent stance, namely technological optimism tinged with uncertainty, was echoed in the media portrayals of egg freezing over the same time period. As soon as egg freezing's experimental label was lifted in 2012, hundreds of news stories and opinion pieces began to be published, often emanating in the U.S. media, then circulating rapidly around the globe. In this regard, the New York Times was at the forefront of egg freezing coverage. Fully 6 months before egg freezing's experimental label was lifted, the New York Times published its first cover story, one that focused on the potential benefits of egg freezing for would-be grandparents who might nudge their 30-something daughters by paying for egg freezing, thereby increasing their own chances for future grandchildren. The second New York Times piece, published 5 days after egg freezing's experimental label was lifted, was an editorial written by the health and science journalist Sarah Elizabeth Richards. An early advocate of egg freezing, Richards told women readers, "We need to talk about our eggs." The following year, she published a book called Motherhood Rescheduled: The New Frontier of Egg Freezing and the Women Who Tried It, 2013, based on her own and three other women's experiences of egg freezing undertaken during the experimental period. A decade on, the tone of the New York Times media coverage had shifted. Stories increasingly focused on the problems of egg freezing, including unequal access to this costly procedure, uncertainties in egg survival rates following freezing and rewarming processes, lack of success among those who had attempted to use their frozen eggs, and the thousands of frozen eggs still remaining in storage, given that most women did not return to use them. The New York Times also began to question the promotion and financing of egg freezing. Stories focused on the aggressive marketing strategies directed toward younger millennial and Gen Z women by clinics that really, really, really want to freeze your eggs, luring them in through ethically questionable, champagne-soaked egg freezing parties and incessant social media advertising. They also covered how egg freezing benefits from companies such as Facebook, now Meta, and Apple were actually conveying a dark message to women workers about the need for mandatory fertility postponement. 5 out of 6 editorials on egg freezing published in the New York Times between 2016 and 2020 were either negative or ambivalent in nature. Most were written by women who had undergone egg freezing with various painful and untoward outcomes. One of the most powerful New York Times editorials published during this period pointed to egg freezing's discriminatory potential as an expensive technology for white women only. Indeed, stereotypical images of the kind of women who might turn to egg freezing were beginning to form in the media. First, these women were presumed to be white and economically privileged. Second, they were often referred to as career women, a term that has no masculine equivalent and is sometimes used in a pejorative sense to criticize women with professional ambitions. The implication was that freezing their eggs, either by choice or necessity, was presumably a way for these career-driven women to climb the corporate ladder. But was this true? In a prescient article titled "Portrayals of Healthy Women Seeking Oocyte Cryopreservation," the bioethicist Heidi Merdes questioned whether this image of egg-freezing women was, in fact, correct, or whether it oversimplified women's egg-freezing motivations and experiences. Meredith pointed to 3 distinct ways in which egg-freezing women were being cast. First, as selfish career-pursuing women. Second, as victims of a male-oriented society that makes it difficult for women to combine motherhood with a good education or professional responsibilities. And third, as wise, proactive women who will not have to depend on oocyte donors should they suffer from age-related infertility. Instead, Merdes asked, might the absence of a male partner be the most common reason why otherwise healthy women are freezing their eggs? Reconceiving egg freezing. In this book, I aim to answer Heidi Merdes's important question. In doing so, I hope to shift the dominant portrayals of egg-freezing women and their motivations. Through in-depth interviews with 150 American women, I have learned definitively that egg-freezing is really not about career planning. Most women who freeze their eggs are successful professionals, ones who can afford this expensive technology, But the notion that women are egg freezing to lean in to their careers, per Sheryl Sandberg's advice, is simply inaccurate. By extension, ASRM's advocacy of the term planned is probably misdirected, given that it too closely associates egg freezing with career planning, thereby overemphasizing women's intentionality in this regard. Notions of egg freezing and the women who do it need to be reconceived, as the stories in this book will show. Most women do not conform to the dominant stereotypes which circulate in the media and some brands of feminist scholarship. To wit, women who freeze their eggs are not 20-somethings, planning for their future careers while also taking time to date, party, and have fun. 30-somethings, climbing the corporate ladder so hard that they forgot to have children. Docile employees, paid by firms to freeze their eggs and put off childbearing indefinitely. Gullible victims, lured into egg freezing by employers and a profit-oriented fertility industry. Or ardent feminists, fighting for reproductive equality with men through egg freezing. Women who freeze their eggs are almost always gainfully employed in careers they enjoy, but by the time they undertake egg freezing, their careers are already well established. Thus, egg freezing is rarely about planned fertility postponement in the sense of women actively deferring, delaying, or postponing their fertility for the sake of their professions. Rather, as we shall see, egg freezing is about unplanned fertility preservation among a group of American women who are hoping to retain and extend their remaining reproductive potential. Women who freeze their eggs are trying to give themselves a decent chance of biologically connected motherhood. They freeze their eggs not to delay parenthood, but rather to enable it at a time when they have met the right partner with whom to become pregnant and have children. Egg freezing, I argue, is their new hope technology, allowing women to imagine what life would be like with the three P's of partnership, pregnancy, and parenthood. Women's turn to egg freezing has not arisen out of nowhere. Egg freezing is women's technological concession to a U.S. gender problem, namely, the challenges women face in their attempts to form meaningful and lasting heterosexual relationships. Most American women who freeze their eggs wish that they could have children now in a committed relationship with a man they love. But in the absence of a partner, women are using egg freezing as a potentially powerful new tool to preserve and extend their fertility, thereby taking some of the pressure off finding a partner while buying time toward the end of their reproductive lifespans. Undertaking egg freezing is not an easy choice for most women. As the stories in this book will reveal, egg freezing can be logistically complicated, physically taxing, financially demanding, emotionally draining, and uncertain in its effects. Furthermore, because the vast majority of women who freeze their eggs are single, going solo to a crowded IVF clinic can be extremely isolating. In this book, women's stories include reflections on their various clinical encounters and stress the need for better fertility education, improvements in patient-centered care and support, and increased access to egg freezing services for single women of all backgrounds. This book also attempts to examine outcomes, asking what becomes of women and their frozen eggs. Although most frozen eggs remain in cold storage, not only for the women I spoke with, but for women around the world, frozen eggs represent future unborn children for many women, bespeaking the immense hopes and investments placed in this still relatively novel fertility preservation strategy. This book explores this futurity, asking what is at stake and what kind of cold comfort frozen eggs can provide for women who are still searching for those three P's of partnership, pregnancy, and parenthood. Egg Freezing Stories. This book is full of women's stories. It is only through such stories that we can come to understand what motivates women to freeze their eggs and what the experience is like. As a medical anthropologist and gender scholar, I have been privileged to gather such egg freezing stories from 150 American women across the country. I met these women through four U.S. IVF clinics, two academic and two private, located along the East Coast corridor and in the heart of Silicon Valley. All of these IVF clinics had active egg freezing programs, some having participated in early clinical trials. They allowed me to circulate a flyer seeking volunteers for an interview-based study of those who had already undertaken the procedure. Many of the women who volunteered were from my home state of Connecticut, especially from the cities of New Haven and Hartford, the state capital. However, over time, most of the women who joined the study came from other major U.S. cities, including New York City, Baltimore, Maryland, Washington, D.C., and its suburbs in Maryland and Virginia, and the San Francisco Bay Area, including Silicon Valley. Reflecting the high degree of professional mobility in the U.S., many women had moved for their jobs. Thus, I also spoke with women living in the Austin, Texas, Boston, Massachusetts, Chicago, Illinois, Denver, Colorado, Los Angeles, California, Savannah, Georgia, Seattle, Washington, St. Louis, Missouri, and the North Carolina Research Triangle cities of Raleigh, Durham, and Chapel Hill. Four women had relocated overseas for jobs in Europe, the Middle East, and Asia. Thus, we spoke across many time zones. Given the potential sensitivity of this subject matter and the profound importance of research ethics, all of the women who volunteered to speak with me were given an informed consent form to read and sign before agreeing to a confidential, audio-recorded interview in a private setting of their own choosing. No one refused to sign, and most women seemed eager to share their stories. Our conversations unfolded in a variety of quiet spaces, including my office, women's homes and offices, libraries, cafes, restaurants, and, in some cases, private rooms in an IVF clinic. When I could not meet a woman because of distance, we spoke by phone or video calls. I always began our conversations with a few basic demographic questions, asking each woman about her age, place of birth, residential history, education, employment, and relationship status, and how she would describe her ethnicity and religion. I also asked a few key questions about reproductive history, including the age of first menstruation, contraceptive usage, and any reproductive problems experienced. I then asked each woman to tell me her egg freezing story in her own words. Women were eloquent and often loquacious storytellers, describing their life circumstances at the time of egg freezing, the details of their decision-making process, and how their egg freezing procedures had unfolded. Their stories were lengthy, often ranging from 1 to 2 hours, and tinged with emotions ranging from happiness, enthusiasm, and relief to sadness, disappointment, and despair. Some women laughed or filled their stories with ironic humor, while others struggled to hold back tears. Many women were angry, primarily at men, but also at doctors. I came to realize through these egg-freezing stories that much was at stake for these women who had put their bodies on the line to preserve their fertility. For them, egg-freezing was much more than a medical procedure. Because these conversations were person-centered, allowing women to express their thoughts, feelings, ideas, opinions, and subjective experiences, I came to realize that egg freezing serves as a kind of repro lens into many other aspects of American women's lives. Women often dwelled on their love lives and breakups, their feelings about the places where they lived, their relationships with family members, the support they received from friend groups, what they liked about their jobs, their experiences with online dating, their perceptions of men, and their opinions about reproductive health care in the U.S. Women also highlighted dimensions of their lives that are rarely covered in egg-freezing discussions, such as religion and the morality of egg-freezing, feelings about their reproductive bodies and sexuality, and how egg-freezing might serve a healing function after illness, heartbreak, or trauma. Of the 150 freezing stories I collected from those who had completed at least one cycle, 114 women had undergone non-medical egg freezing, 33 had undergone medical egg freezing, mostly because of cancer diagnoses, 2 had frozen their eggs because of their husband's sterility, and 1 transgender individual had undergone egg freezing prior to his male gender-affirming transition. I also interviewed 12 women who had not yet completed egg freezing, but had consulted with a physician, started the procedure, started but canceled the procedure, or, in one case, decided not to move forward. Some of these women were referred to me by their friends who had already participated in my study, or they found out about my study and volunteered on their own. Overall, 14 women I interviewed were either friend or self-referrals. The rest of the women contacted me through flyers circulated by email and hard copy in the 4 participating IVF clinics. I also interviewed 8 male and 3 female IVF physicians. Their clinics were located in diverse regions of the country, including the East Coast, Washington, D.C., the Southeast, Florida and Georgia, the Midwest, Michigan and Missouri, the Mountain Region, Colorado, and the Northwest, Oregon, as well as Southern California and Hawaii. Through these interviews, I was able to get a sense of how egg freezing was unfolding across the country, and I include excerpts of these interviews at various points in this book. I also interviewed 2 individuals with in-depth knowledge of demographic disparities in infertility care and education in the U.S. The discussion of educational disparities is critical to the arguments that will unfold. All in all, I conducted audio-recorded interviews with 176 individuals, including 166 women, 150 of whom had completed at least one cycle of egg freezing. This is the largest ethnographic exploration of egg freezing ever undertaken, not only in the U.S., but anywhere in the world. At the core of this book are women's egg-freezing stories, gathered over 2 years, hundreds of hours of interviewing, and thousands of hours of verbatim transcription. In this book, I aim to carefully preserve women's egg-freezing stories in their own words, while also signaling points of laughter, exclamation, exasperation, and tears. All of the names used are pseudonyms. Particular details of women's lives are also covered by more general terms, e.g., academic physician rather than oncologist at such and such university, so as to protect their anonymity. But women's stories, with their verbatim quotes, are real. This book is centered on the stories of the more than 100 women who had completed at least one cycle of non-medical egg freezing. Although women undertaking medical egg freezing are vitally important and will be introduced to readers later in the book, women undertaking non-medical egg freezing constitute the majority of new users of this technology, not only in the US, but elsewhere around the world. Who are these women? As we will see in the next section, they compose a particular egg-freezing demographic of highly educated professional women like Kayla, who are now turning to egg-freezing by the thousands. The egg-freezing demographic. How can we characterize American women who freeze their eggs? As my study clearly reveals, egg-freezing women are part of a particular U.S. demographic defined by 8 key features. Women who compose the egg-freezing demographic are 1. Racially and ethnically diverse, 2. Secular, 3. Late 30-something, 4. High earning, 5. Highly educated, 6. Professionally successful, 7. Heterosexual but single and/or 8. Facing ongoing partnership problems. All 8 features do not apply to every single woman, but these characteristics are widely shared across this group, having major relevance for the ways in which women's egg freezing experiences unfold. A brief synopsis will paint a clearer picture of this egg freezing demographic, which, in turn, will help to inform all of the stories that follow. Racially and ethnically diverse. Women who freeze their eggs come from a variety of racial and ethnic backgrounds, backgrounds that are reflective of the cosmopolitan urban areas in which professional women tend to live and where IVF clinics are also located. In this study, slightly more than 2/3 of the women, 69%, self-identified as white, but nearly 1/3, 31%, identified as non-white. Among these, Asian American women of East, Southeast, and South Asian heritage backgrounds constituted the single largest minority group at 18% overall. Black, Latina, and mixed race women were also represented, making up about 3-4% each of the study population. Women of Middle Eastern heritage, both Arab and Persian, also volunteered for the study, at 2% of the total. 16 women, 14%, had been born in other countries, specifically Canada, Chile, China, Colombia, Ethiopia, Ghana, Guatemala, India, Japan, Pakistan, Poland, Taiwan, and the United Kingdom, as well as Puerto Rico, the Caribbean island still designated as a U.S. territory. 2 had retained their birth citizenships. However, most of these women had been raised in the U.S. or had come for schooling, eventually obtaining U.S. citizenship. Minority women's specific concerns regarding egg freezing will be taken up later in this book. But suffice it to say here that egg freezing in the U.S. is not limited to white women only, as diverse women's stories, including immigrant women's stories, showcased throughout this book, will show. Secular. Women of many religious backgrounds are also freezing their eggs, often with the explicit support of religious authorities. More than half of the women in this study, 58%, had been raised in Christian households, both Protestant, 26%, and Catholic, 32%, with Catholic women representing the single largest group in the study. As seen in Kayla's story, Catholic women may have particular moral concerns regarding egg freezing because the Catholic Church is singularly restrictive, disallowing all forms of reproductive technology. In contrast, Jewish religious authorities have been exceptionally supportive of egg freezing. Not surprisingly, then, Jewish women were significantly overrepresented in the study, at 18% of the total, even though Jews make up only 2.2% of the U.S. population. Hindu and Muslim women, mostly from South Asian immigrant families, each made up 3 to 4% of the overall group, while women who identified as Buddhists made up 2% of the total. Nearly 16% of women had no religious background, especially women from East Asian immigrant families, who often identified themselves as agnostic, atheist, or secular. No matter their religious upbringing, 90% of egg-freezing women said that they no longer practiced any kind of religion and considered themselves to be secular. Many women identified themselves as spiritual but non-religious, SBNR, a category that is growing among younger generation Americans. Having said this, 10% of women in the study considered themselves to be practicing Christians, Jews, or Muslims. For these religious women, egg freezing had consequences for notions of virginity, marriage, and motherhood, issues that will be explored further. Late 30-something. As studies around the world consistently show, women who freeze their eggs are most frequently in their late 30s, generally between the ages of 36 and 38. This proved to be true in my study as well, where the average age at first egg freezing was 36.6. In fact, nearly three-quarters, 73%, of women in the study were in their late 30s, ages 35 to 39, by the time they pursued egg freezing, and 10% were in their 40s, ages 40 to 43. With more than four-fifths of women aged 35 and above, only 17% of women froze their eggs in their early 30s, ages 30 to 34, indicating the degree to which egg freezing is a late 30-something endeavor. Only one woman was younger than 30 when she froze her eggs. But she was a special case because her father was a retiring IVF physician who encouraged her to freeze her eggs before he left his practice. The stark absence of 20-somethings in this and other egg-freezing studies suggests that younger women have not yet been convinced to try this costly and invasive technology, including as a tool for career planning. Furthermore, cost-benefit analyses suggest that egg freezing does not really make sense for fertile 20-somethings, many of whom will eventually partner and conceive without any technological assistance. Instead, egg freezing is most applicable to the lives of 30-something women who, as we will see throughout this book, are weighing the benefits of this technology against its high costs. High earning. Indeed, egg freezing is expensive, averaging between $10,000 to $15,000 per cycle, but costing anywhere from $7,500 to $18,000 per cycle, depending on the IVF clinic and the amount and cost of accompanying medications. Women must also pay annual storage fees, which average between $500 to $1,000, but can range from $300 to $1,500, depending on the clinic and its egg bank. If women return to use their frozen eggs, then they must pay for the second half of an IVF cycle, which includes rewarming the frozen eggs, fertilizing them through ICSI techniques, and transferring the best quality embryo or embryos to the uterus, a process that can cost an additional $6,000 on average. Given these high costs, only women with substantial financial means can afford this technology, making it out of reach for the vast majority of American women. In this study, most women were entirely self-supporting and able to pay for egg freezing on their own. Although well-to-do parents often volunteered to pay for egg freezing cycles, nearly 90% of the women were able to pay for their egg freezing cycles by themselves, relying on their salaries, savings accounts, family inheritances, or health insurance provided by their employers. More than half, 57%, of the women had undertaken one egg freezing cycle, while one-third, 31%, had undertaken two cycles, and 12% had undertaken three or four cycles, effectively multiplying their expenses. Although I did not routinely ask women about their salaries, a few reported high salaries in the six-figure range, for example, $120,000, $148,000, $175,000, $200,000, $275,000, $325,000, $500,000, and $600,000. Such salaries put these women significantly above the $82,535 annual salary made by the average U.S. taxpayer. Most of these egg-freezing women were in the top 10% of earners, who average $158,002 annually, and some were in the top 5%, who average $309,348. In short, most of these high-earning women could easily afford their egg-freezing cycles. Still, their major recommendation was that the price be brought down to make the technology more accessible and affordable to lower- and middle-income women, including some of their own friends and relatives. In my study, about 10% of women fell into this middle-income bracket. Even though most were well-employed and self-supporting, they did not make such large salaries, for example, $70,000 as opposed to $170,000, and some were paying off substantial student loans. These women often struggled to put together the money for even one cycle, resorting to zero-interest credit cards, small loans, or depletion of their savings accounts. For example, a woman who worked as a federal regulator in a government agency in Washington, D.C., had accumulated just enough money in her savings account to afford a $15,000 egg-freezing cycle. But when only one egg was retrieved and frozen, she was bereft, considering her $15,000 expenditure to be a sunk cost. In contrast, an academic physician spent $35,000 from her savings on three cycles that produced 55 eggs, the highest number retrieved and frozen by any woman in this study. For her, egg freezing was inherently affordable, something that she compared to the cost of another car. For most women, being able to afford these high-cost egg freezing cycles made the choice less difficult, and the egg freezing itself brought many women some measure of success and relief. Indeed, women in this study froze an average of 18 eggs, a number close to 20, which has been recommended for a woman in her late 30s to achieve at least one live birth. Highly educated. Women's affluence was clearly tied to their high levels of education. Most women in this study had not only completed college, nearly 80% of them had earned advanced degrees, including master's degrees, 45%, medical degrees, 14%, doctoral degrees, 10%, and law degrees, 7%. More than 10% of all women had earned dual advanced degrees, such as MD-PhDs, MD-MPHs, and PhD-MPPs. Furthermore, among these highly educated American women, one-third, 32%, had attended Ivy League institutions, and another one-quarter, 26%, had attended highly ranked public, e.g., the University of California, Berkeley, or private, e.g., Massachusetts Institute of Technology, universities. In other words, well over half, 58%, of these American women had attended so-called elite academic institutions. As a group, they were exceptionally well-educated high achievers whose years of schooling had prepared them for diverse and rewarding careers. Successful professionals. Most women in this study were not only gainfully employed, they were successful professionals with impressive job skills and sometimes remarkable career trajectories. Although the women's job descriptions varied considerably, their careers tended to cluster in 10 key areas. The largest single category consisted of 1. Women in health care, including many physicians who had frozen their eggs, as well as nurses, nurse practitioners, healthcare management professionals, and women in the pharmaceutical sector. The healthcare category was followed, in rank order, by 2, women in government, including...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.